It's time for Security Now. Steve Gibson is here. We're going to talk sci-fi recommendations, smartwatches for children that are really super smart, spies on your kids' wrists, bugs in Mozilla's signature verification, and a whole lot more. Then a new tool which has revealed a flaw in pretty much every browser on the market, XSinator. It's all coming up next on Security Now.
Podcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
This is Security Now with Steve Gibson, episode 848, recorded December 7th, 2021, XSinator. Security Now is brought to you by Worldwide Technology and Fortinet. When was the last time your company updated your security strategy? Are your business assets protected? WWT combines strategy and execution to secure your organization and drive business outcomes. Visit wwt.com/twit to get started. And by IT Pro TV. Start or advance your IT career with the wonderful instructors at IT Pro TV. Visit itpro.tv/security now for an additional 30% off all consumer subscriptions for the lifetime of your active subscription. Just use the code SN30 at checkout. And by Bitwarden. Get the password manager that offers a robust and cost-effective solution that can drastically increase your chances of staying safe online. Get started with a free trial of a Teams or Enterprise plan, or get started for free across all devices as an individual user at bitwarden.com/twit. It's time for Security Now, the show you wait all week for. Here they are, the Security Now guys, and Steve Gibson, welcome. It's good to see you, the guy, the man in charge of Security Now.
Leo, great to be with you as we plow into December.
Plow, I tell you. Yes.
Yes. This is the first Tuesday of the month since the month began on Wednesday, last Wednesday. So this is, as I've mentioned before, the latest in the month that we can have Patch Tuesday. That'll be next Tuesday. So we'll wait to see what happens. The hope is that we're going to get printing back for Windows.
We've been hoping that for a while, haven't we?
It'd be a real Christmas present. Yes.
Oh, man.
Yes, Virginia.
Someday.
You can print.
Yes.
A group of five German researchers took a different kind of look at a means by which a site we're visiting can work behind our backs using deliberately created features of JavaScript and the state of the art of web pages, the so-called document object model, to infer privacy-violating things about us and our relationships to other websites. So today's topic is the site they created, XSinator, XS as in cross site, XSinator. And anybody who wants to jump ahead can go to XSinator, XSinator.com, and click the Test My Browser button. And within a minute or so, you will see a whole bunch of red, which are specific instances. This thing runs, I think it's 37 or 38. They start numbering at zero, bless their hearts. So I don't remember whether it's 37 or 35 and you add one for the zero-based counting. But you'll see all of the places where their test has verified that the browser you're using can fall to some of these tests. We're going to talk about that in some detail at the end. But Tavis Ormandy has been busy. He found a bad bug in Mozilla's NSS. That's their own, I assume it stands for Netscape Privacy or Netscape Security Suite, because it's always been part of the Firefox, and then they split it out. A very nice and actually widely used open source security library. He found a problem, a bad problem, in their signature verification. We're also going to look at the horrifying lack of security in something that I didn't know existed, Leo, smartwatches for children.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, bad
idea.
It's
not just smartwatches. We were talking about this on MacBreak Weekly, the Life 360 app that you put on your phone to track your kids. And your family members, just a horrific privacy.
Well, and wait till you hear how bad these things are. We also have another six VPN services have been banned by Russia, and we get to say Roskomnadzor many times. We also have Microsoft happily softening the glue between Windows 11 and Edge. So we have a bit of good news there. But bad guys have found a new way of slipping malware into our machines. There's a botnet using the Bitcoin blockchain as its backup communications medium. We have HP with more than 150 printer models in dire need of firmware updates, doubtless affecting some of our listeners. I'm going to then briefly touch on a little sci-fi note and update our listeners about SpinRite. An interesting thing will be happening, maybe not tonight, but tomorrow for sure. Which is to say, as soon as I'm done with the podcast and have recovered. And then we're going to look at this new research into an entirely new class of cross-site privacy breaches, which affect every browser, mobile and desktop. And as I said, a test everyone can run. And I got a picture that was posted in the SpinRite development news group yesterday that I immediately knew I had to share. So, you know, Lori looked at it and said, "Is that yours?" I was like, "No, honey, that's not." But it's a dedicated tester.
All right, we're going to take a little break. Before we do, though, I want to actually make a pretty special announcement, and I wanted to get you involved in this, Steve, as well. I don't know if you know of a company, you probably don't, called RMC, the Resource Management Concepts. They help manage fleets and security for government agencies like the Air Force and the Department of Homeland Security and the Navy and other commercial entities. They're a really cool company. And we got an email, I think it was a few weeks ago, from David Hickman over there. He's a VP at RMC, saying he would like to sign up. He says he's a big fan of security now and really appreciates the information he gets for his business. He would like to sign up, he said, for Club TWiT for his employees. And they have purchased, and I don't know if people know this, we have corporate membership plans. They've purchased 300 licenses for their company. And we were just so blown away and so impressed. And David, I just wanted to thank you and let Steve know about it, because it really is because of you, Steve, and the really valuable information you pass along, that their security and IT professionals wanted this information, and his company wanted to give them security now. Basically, it's a gift for the holidays. So,
wow,
isn't that amazing?
Cool.
Cool. So, David, hello to everybody at Resource Management Concepts. Guess what? You're going to be listening to a lot of this guy next year. And welcome to Club TWiT. And for anybody who wants to know more, we really love the corporate memberships. If you go to twit.tv/clubtwit, it's the ad-free versions of all of our shows. But you'll see we do have a corporate plan, and it gives you a significant discount. You can get as many seats as you want. If you go to twit.tv/clubtwit, it starts with 5 seats, so it can be a small business, and it can go up from there. But David bought 300 copies of our show ad-free because he really appreciates it. And we appreciate you, David, and everybody at Resource Management Concepts. Great company, RMC. And I think they're going to be even smarter. Thanks to you, Steve. So we just wanted to say hello and welcome to the club. Our show today, let's get some ads in, and the people at Resource Management Concepts will not be seeing these ads, but the rest of you will. Our show today brought to you by Worldwide Technology, and we are also big fans of WWT and Fortinet, and I know a name you know very well, Steve. WWT offers security solutions and services to protect your business. Attackers are always updating their strategies. This is one of the things that's scary. You know, the zero day, that means something has come down the pike no one's seen before. Are you updating your security practices? Because that same old strategy you used last week isn't going to work next week. WWT helps your organization prepare and combat next generation threats. And what a great company to partner with, a company that has a vision, the services, the capabilities needed to deliver security controls to reduce the risk for your organization. WWT does all of that. Their team provides resources and platforms that make it possible. Over three decades of experience, they have a proven track record to truly help you succeed. We know it because Lisa and I went out in March of last year. Gosh, seems like an eon ago, right before COVID. To visit the Advanced Technology Center, and we were just blown away. Some of the case studies you'll find at the WWT website really tell you what WWT can do. They've worked with a large healthcare organization. The healthcare organization was, as many are, moving to certified electronic health record technology, and they wanted a security risk assessment. By the way, good idea, prudent thing to do. WWT's consultants came in. They used their expert knowledge, state-of-the-art tools, analysis, to complete their assessment. They found that 90% of the vulnerabilities, there were many findings, but this is one of them that everybody should listen to. 90% of the vulnerabilities that were found could be fixed just by putting in a comprehensive, systematic approach for patching. Well, you knew that. And then WWT came back because they stay with you forever. They really are there to help you to do training and repetition with the staff. So that they would know how to, you know, what the best practices were. They would know how to be secure in this healthcare system. They worked with a very well-known, I won't say the name, retail bank. They wanted an infrastructure that could survive a catastrophic cybersecurity event. I think that's what everybody wants these days. WWT helped them do that. They also, and this is almost just a kind of a side benefit, they also reduced system outages by 40%. And then they did infrastructure automation, also very useful, which saved the bank 48%. So in effect, they saved the bank so much money that it paid for itself. WWT can do a lot to help your security posture. Risk management, endpoint security, network security, identity and access management, cloud security. They work on every front. And as I mentioned, training as well, and security assessments. See how WWT and Fortinet can protect your business assets and intellectual property with a holistic security approach. And as always, and I always emphasize this, WWT understands your business is not security. Your business is your business. And everything WWT does is about making your business more successful. They want to make sure they're exactly congruent with your business goals. That's really important. And they know business, so they can do it. WWT.com/twit. Let Worldwide Technology help you improve your security posture, improve your performance. WWT.com/twit. Worldwide Technology. Make a new world happen. We thank them so much for supporting security now. All right, Steve, let me cue up the picture of the week.
Okay. So this is not something that we expect all of our testers to do. Let me just make that clear. Most people just, you know, boot a machine they have with a USB thumb drive and run the development release to see how it does and then report their results. This individual is clearly a technician or of some sort. If you look, Leo, if you scroll down to the top of the next page, you'll see the SpinRite screen that he was seeing.
Look at all the different devices.
Yeah. So he's got 13 drives hooked up to this system. And there's a little extra goodies that users will never see, which are here for development. You can see along the top, it says 80, 81, 82, 83. Those are up through 8 Charlie. Those are the BIOS designations, and they're white because SpinRite was able to figure out which one of the drives that it has hardware access to the BIOS is referring to. There's no, unfortunately, in the BIOS, there's no way to associate BIOS designations with physical drive designations, yet SpinRite has to, so that it's able not to confuse users by showing them a drive that the BIOS sees and that it sees. So one of the challenges has been to create this association between the BIOS designations and the drives that SpinRite has direct hardware access to. So you can see, for example, down at the bottom is 80, the fourth from the bottom. So that would be the drive that he booted from, a little 264 megabyte thumb drive. And then there's 8A, 8B, and 8C, which are other drives which are accessible only to the BIOS and not to SpinRite. But anyways, and then also there's a little cyan column to the down the right hand edge of the drive identity that shows how many seconds it took for SpinRite to identify and qualify that drive for operation. It performs a whole bunch of confidence testing, you know, gets the name, the serial number, all the smart data. It also then performs a series of reads and writes in order to verify that it's able to do so. When we were having IRQ problems, some of those tests would take a long time. And so they'd sometimes say, you know, 26 seconds or something. So that was another little clue that would allow us to know what was going on. But in that first picture, we see a little, it looks like a mini ITX form factor motherboard, and drives just spread all over the table. He actually numbered them. You can see a little yellow column of numbers on the upper on that first image, labeled 1 through 13, and then he drew lines to show where all of these 13 drives are that are scattered around the table. Anyway, it was just so unusual that I
really
like
this drive with the massive heatsink on.
Yeah, he made some. Yeah, above and below it, you can see it's sandwiched between heat sinks. Yeah. And he made some comment saying this used to run hot, but apparently not anymore.
No,
so
no. Do it anyway, yourself, just, heat sinks. I love it.
Just a fun little one
of
a kind.
Crazy test bench. Look at that. Wow.
Yeah, and SpinRite found all the drives and is working correctly on all of those.
Nice.
So we're getting there. I'll talk a little bit about the past week's adventure in a minute. But Tavis found a bad bug in NSS. Of course, this is Tavis Ormandy at Google. He's part of their zero-day group. He discovered and quietly reported an important bug in Mozilla's widely used open source NSS security suite last Wednesday. With the bug quickly patched, Tavis tweeted, he said, quote, "This is a major memory corruption flaw in NSS. Almost any use of NSS is affected. The Mozilla advisory is here," and he provided a link, actually, there's two links. Twitter shortened one of them. Anyway, NSS is used by Mozilla, of course. It's the reason, for example, that Firefox sometimes behaves differently on Windows than other browsers, because every other browser uses Windows' intrinsic security library that built into Windows, whereas Firefox brings along its own. And that's sort of a mixed blessing. it means there's a lot more for them to maintain, but it does give them sort of a more of their own containment and more portability. But aside from just Mozilla, Red Hat, SUSE, and many other products also use NSS. Of course, Firefox, but also Thunderbird, SeaMonkey, and the Firefox OS. There's the open source client applications, Evolution, Pigeon, Apache OpenOffice, and LibreOffice are also NSS clients. Server products, as I mentioned, Red Hat, their directory server, their certificate system, and the mod NSS SSL module for Apache is also NSS-based. Over on the server side, Oracle is using NSS, including their communications messaging server and Oracle Directory Server Enterprise Edition. And as I mentioned, SUSE, their Linux Enterprise Server supports NSS, as does Apache. So it's important if there's something bad there. In other locations, Tavis, that is other than Twitter, Tavis commented, quote, if you're a vendor that distributes NSS in your products, you will most likely need to update or backport the patch. Mozilla plans to produce a thorough list of affected APIs, but the summary is that any standard use of NSS is affected. The bug is simple to reproduce and affects multiple platforms. So in other words, anyone using NSS should focus less on worrying about which specific APIs are vulnerable. I would just argue, don't worry about that. Just update your use of the security suite. NSS versions prior to 3.73 or 3.68.1 in the ESR are vulnerable. And that's all versions since October of 2012 until those releases. Tavis said, quote, we believe all versions of NSS since 3.14, which was released October 2012, are vulnerable. However, for what it's worth, according to Mozilla, this vulnerability does not impact Firefox, for whatever reason, but all PDF viewers and email clients which use NSS for their signature verification are believed to be impacted. That's where the problem is. It's in the signature verification component. Mozilla said applications using NSS for handling signatures encoded with CMS, S/MIME, PKCS7 or PKCS12 are likely to be impacted. Applications using NSS for certificate validation or other TLS, X.509, OCSP, or CRL functionality may be impacted depending upon how they configure NSS. So, just for the record, the exploitation of this during signature verification can lead to a heap-based buffer overflow when handling DER-encoded DSA or RSA-PSS signatures in email clients and PDF viewers. The impact of successful heap overflow exploitation can range from a simple program crash to potentially arbitrary code execution, up through bypassing security software if code execution is achieved. So again, if anyone is using NSS for some project, be sure to get an updated build. So that's the, all of the past 9 years of NSS up until this was patched. So essentially, I'm sure anything anybody has been using until very recently when they just fixed it. Okay. I didn't know, you did, Leo, but I didn't know that there was a thing such as cheap smartwatches for kids and babies, to which we would have the refrain, what could possibly go wrong? Dr. Webb, which is an AV firm, security firm based in Russia, recently examined four inexpensive smartwatches designed and marketed specifically for kids. Now, before I go any further, allow me to just suggest to anyone listening to this podcast that if they have that on their Christmas list, avoid any temptation whatsoever you might have to purchase a $50 smartwatch for anyone you know. Dr. Webb's report is very detailed, so I'm not going to bother to describe what they found for each of the four devices. But discussing a representative example will be informative and should be sufficient to forestall any desire anyone might have to put one of these little spyware beasties onto the wrist of anyone they know or care about. So Dr. Webb introduces the subject with a little bit of background, which I've shortened a bit. They wrote, "Parents always strive to take care of their children. Technology innovations help them reach this goal through various wearables like smartwatches and GPS trackers. These devices are getting close to smartphones in functionality. For example, many of them can track the child's location and travel route. These devices can also make and answer phone and video calls, receive SMS and voicemail, take pictures, and listen to their surroundings. It's even possible to enable the remote control of the device." Okay, I don't know what that means, but said Dr. Webb has analyzed the potential threats that such gadgets can pose to parents and their children. During their daily operation, they wrote, "these devices collect and transmit data to the manufacturer's servers and make it available to parents through their personal accounts. The information obtained with smartwatches is very sensitive. If malicious actors get their hands over such information, it can put children in great danger. To understand the vulnerability and dangers of children's smartwatches, Dr. Webb's specialists analyzed several popular models chosen based upon public popularity ratings and purposefully selected models from different price ranges. We purchased all smartwatches anonymously from an online store. We carried out both static and dynamic analysis during the inspection. We searched for potential implants in the software and possible undocumented features, as well as checked network activity, transmitted data, and how it was secured." Okay, so one of the four devices they examined was the LRE Kid Phone 4G smartwatch. And yes, and isn't it pretty, Leo? I mean, it's beautiful.
Just like mommy and daddy's.
Exactly. Okay, get a load of that. This is what this beautiful looking device. Several versions, they wrote, of the Ilari Kid Phone 4G watches exist. They're based on different hardware platforms, but they all run an Android OS, and their firmware differs slightly. The primary threat of this model comes from its installed software. Its firmware has a built-in app for over-the-air updating, and this app has Trojan functionality. Firstly, they wrote, the application sends the child's geolocation data to its own remote server. Secondly, we found malicious code inside it, which is detected by Dr. Webb. That is, you know, remember, these guys are AV people. It's detected by their antiviral, anti-malware technology as android.downloader.3894. Every time the watch turns on or network connection changes, this code launches two malicious modules, android.downloader.812.origin and android.downloader.1049.origin. They connect to the command and control server to transmit various information and to receive commands. By default, the modules connect to the server once every 8 hours. Because of this, a long delay exists between the first connection and the first time the watch is turned on, thus reducing the chance of discovery. The android.downloader.812.origin module sends the user's mobile phone number and SIM card information, geolocation data, and information about the device itself to the command and control server. In response, it can receive commands to change the frequency of subsequent requests to the server, update the module, download, install, run and uninstall apps, and load web pages. The Android downloader .1049.origin module sends SIM card information and mobile phone number information, geolocation data, a large number of data about the device and installed apps, as well as the info about the number of SMS, phone calls, and contacts in the phone book to the command and control server. Thus, Android downloader 3894, hidden in this watch, that's that parent, can be used for cyber espionage, displaying ads, and installing unwanted or even malicious apps. Okay, now, you put the picture on the screen before, which is, for me, it's sort of disarming. It's a consumer product, and it's adorable and appealing looking. Our listeners who don't have video can't see what you and I are seeing, Leo, but they're very professional looking, attractive consumer devices. They look like toys, but they're definitely not. Anyone who purchases one of these little devils is not only exposing their children to remote anonymous attackers and trackers, but also bringing an open microphone into the lives of those children's parents. Who knows what might be overheard in what's presumed to be a private setting, and who would be to blame? Now, I fully recognize that the likelihood of any specific child or their parents being targeted through this is diminishingly low. I don't mean to suggest otherwise, but knowing what we now know, who would feel comfortable strapping one of those loose cannons onto their child's wrist? And that's my point. The photo of these devices is utterly at odds with what's going on inside them. It's deeply unsettling because they look so cute and harmless. Yet inside that colorful soft plastic shell is a communicating computer running a Trojanized Android OS, which autonomously connects to a remote command and control server, and Amazon sells these things. The bullet points on Amazon's page says, under security and peace of mind for parents, monitor child's location, set safe zones, and use remote audio monitoring through free parent-controlled app. Get alert if the child uses the built-in SOS button. Under easy communication, stay in touch, have a two-way voice call, use voice chat, or send emojis. Limit contacts to those authorized through the app to avoid undesired communication. Under user-friendly and comfortable, kids' phone watch features, math game, and interface with emoticons. And then finally, under other features, class time mode, alarm call, pedometer, up to 4 days standby time, Ilari safe family free multilingual Android iOS compatible app, ability to add other Ilari smartwatch users to friends list. So the watches that the Dr. Webb researchers examined had default passwords of 123456. And most of them don't bother to employ encryption in their communications. They just use plain text. What this brings to mind is the glaring gap in consumer protection that currently exists in our tech industry. Because, the difference between purchasing a well-designed Wi-Fi router that might still have an inadvertent security vulnerability and this colorful plastic child's watch that communicates without encryption with remotely located command and control servers, continually sending back all of the child's movements and is able to autonomously download any additional software at any time, to me seems extreme. It takes the consumerness way down to sort of a different lower level. And who knows what they're doing? In the U.S., the engineers and scientists at Underwriters Labs are able to test toasters and vacuum cleaners because they're able to carefully examine and stress test the important functional safety aspects of those consumer products. But today's text gadgets, you know, tech gadgets, are closed black boxes which are actively hostile to reverse engineering. I don't see any solution to this mess other than to take every possible precaution. You know, we're able to place our IoT devices on their own segmented network. If these wristwatches also have Wi-Fi radios, placing them on the IoT Wi-Fi would help. But they can still spy.
And the whole point of this is to follow your kid when they're out and about, not in the home network.
Right. Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, and so, you know, to me, I would stay as far away from this Ellari brand as possible. And I guess the only advice I would have, I mean, I could imagine as you listen to these bullet points, these seem like cool things.
Yeah, they're the kind of features you'd want in a watch that's tracking your child.
Yeah, like, but use Garmin
use a company, you know, an American company to begin with, I would say. Yeah.
Yes.
Apple
exactly.
has watches that do all of this, probably at a much higher price, but they're available.
I just got a chill when I looked at these beautiful looking consumer devices for $50 and imagine, you know, and we know how much kids like to emulate their parents, right? So I'm sure Johnny would love to have a watch like Daddy has.
Right.
You know,
Daddy may even want Johnny to have these capabilities.
Right.
That's the thing. Daddy and Mommy want to track the kids. The problem is who else is doing it?
Right. Right.
So you're going to turn on all those features because that's why you bought the watch.
Is there a really low-end Apple iPhone?
No, there's an Apple Watch SE that they make that you can configure for kids, and that's probably the way to go. But it's a few hundred bucks. It's not cheap.
Yeah. Again, to all of our listeners, buyer beware. Yeah. If you want this, I'd go Apple. I mean,
we know
that it will be as well designed as it can be. I just don't know how you do any. I mean, you know, maybe Samsung, some other high-end Android device. Or what about any of the Garmin-y sorts of things? Do any of the activity trackers do location?
Problem is, there are a lot of kids trackers in this category. Because they're inexpensive. You don't want to give a kid a $300 watch. They're small. They're built for kids. Their functionality is considerably more limited because parents don't want kids, you know, making random phone calls either.
Right.
So there are, you know,
look at all the spam we got on our phones. You don't want your kid answering the phone like some random stranger in Lord only knows
Hello?
Where.
Hey, how's your auto warranty?
What?
Yeah, that could be a problem.
Oh, anyway, for me, this was a wake-up call, and I wanted to share it because, boy, you know, it is, however bad you think it could possibly be, this suggests it's a lot worse than that. You know, the people selling this just don't give a crap about security or privacy, and you don't want to strap that on to any child's wrist under any circumstances. Last Thursday, speaking of Russia, Russia's internet policing agency, Roskomnadzor, announced the ban of an additional 6 VPN services, bringing now the total number of banned VPN providers to 15. The most recent 6 bannings were Betternet, Lantern, X-VPN, Cloudflare Warp, Tachyon VPN, and Private Tunnel. Roskomnadzor sent a request to inform the Center for Monitoring and Control of the Public Communications Network about the removal of those additional 6 services from the systems of all registered Russian companies and public organizations. They can no longer be used. So the list of banned services now reads, Hola VPN, Express VPN, Keep Solid VPN Unlimited, Nord VPN, Speedify VPN, IP Vanish VPN, Viper VPN, Opera VPN, and Proton VPN, to which we add those other six. These services collectively have all been banned due to their principled refusal to abide by Roskomnadzor's demands to connect their systems to the FGIS database, because doing so would defeat the entire purpose of using a VPN connection, which is, that purpose is, to bypass access restrictions and obtain anonymity, which is a level of individual freedom which apparently makes Russia's leaders uncomfortable. Back in 2019, Russian authorities gave all VPN vendors operating in-country the ultimatum to comply with their rules or else be banned. The only vendor who responded positively before the deadline was, I guess not surprisingly, the Moscow-based Kaspersky with their secure connection product. You know, they were already terminating the VPN, you know, in-country, so they had nothing, you know, they didn't have to change anything. The non-complying VPN vendors either established new servers just outside the Russian borders or attempted to employ traffic masking techniques, which are known to work well against the Great Firewall of China. But the Russian authorities gradually caught up with those services also, which, you know, were trying to bypass the new regulation and have banned them in multiple action rounds. As Russian users uninstall banned products and turn to what few remaining products remain, the Russian authorities evaluate which ones have then emerged as the most popular and add them to the growing block list. So, you know, if you're in Russia, good luck. It's going to be very difficult for you to have private and secure communications. Or you aren't going to be able to use one of these mainstream high-profile VPNs. I'm sure there are ways around this that people inside of Russia are aware of. And Leo, I'm aware of my need to take a sip.
Okay. You like our holiday decor, by the way? It's all...
Oh, it's very nice. Yes. I like... You got a sock on the door behind you, a stocking, I think.
Yes, there's a stocking. Yep. There's a couple of stockings. Yep.
And we have some poinsettias, I see.
Yes.
Very nice.
And one of the stockings is for Ozzy. One of them is an Angry Bird stocking. You'll notice that the Mr. Robot mask has a elf hat on.
Yes, very festive. Nice. Very festive. I think he should keep that. That looks good.
It looks good on him, doesn't it?
No,
I actually like this time of year. I look forward to it all year long. You'll be getting our your TWiT Christmas card soon with...
Oh, cool.
It's the meta version of our Christmas card.
You've been talking
it's
about
gonna
it.
Be,
I'm
think you're
going to
enjoy it.
To seeing it.
We're all virtual.
Cool.
Our show today, thank you, Steve. Our show today brought to you by IT Pro TV. We love these guys. It's a great time to be in IT. I mean, COVID just made IT more important, not less important, right? That's the thing. IT is a necessity. And if you want to get into one of the many IT careers out there, or even if you're already a seasoned IT pro, IT Pro TV has something for everybody. It's a great way to get that first certificate, the certificate you need to get that job, make yourself desirable to employers. Because IT Pro TV is the official training partner of CompTIA, it's a good place, really good place to get those certs that, you know, many people start out with, the A+. Or Security Plus or Network Plus. There's actually Linux Plus. There's lots of these. Those are really good certs to start with. But it doesn't stop there if you're already in IT. It's a very good way to expand your knowledge, enhance your skills, to recertify for those certs you already have and to get new certs as well. And the best part is it's easy. You can watch anywhere, computer, tablet. They've got apps for Roku and Apple TV. It just couldn't be easier to watch. 20 to 30 minute chunks, so watch during lunch hour. Still have time to play a little Frisbee afterwards. It's going to fit in with your schedule. And also, because they have transcripts,
By the way, I should mention 5,800 hours of downloadable content. And all of it has transcripts, which you can search, so you can jump right to the thing you need to know. You know, I don't understand question four on the A-plus test. By the way, they have that too, practice tests. Let me go look into that a little bit more, and you can jump right to that part. It's got everything you need to be really easy. Every month this year, they've been doing special events. This is, December is Python month. To wrap up 2021, which I love. I mean, this is a great language, a very useful language for automation in IT. They're going to do a webinar day after tomorrow, December 9th, 2 p.m. Eastern. Most in-demand IT jobs for 2022. Ronnie Wong is going to host that. If I know Ronnie, he's going to be dressed to the nines. Should be a lot of fun. And that, of course, all of their webinars are available for watching later. But it's nice to be there live because you can ask questions and so forth. This coming weekend, December 11th and 12th, their free weekend features courses like Introduction to Programming using Python, Python Programming, Python Data Model, Python for Security. This is great stuff. Free this weekend. So look, start or advance your IT career with the wonderful instructors. They call them edutainers at IT Pro TV. Visit itpro.tv/securitynow. We've got a great discount still for you. This would be, by the way, a great holiday gift for somebody you know, somebody maybe in your family or a friend who's got the knowledge and the desire to work in IT, but maybe he doesn't have that job yet. And you're going to get 30% off. They're going to get 30% off all consumer subscriptions for the lifetime of their active subscription with the offer code SN30. Why do we do that? Well, because they're great. They're nice people. But also, that lets them know you saw it here. So please use that offer code SN for SecurityNow 30 for their 30% discount. itpro.tv/securitynow. Offer code SN30. It's a great deal. And it's a great company. Great people. Tim and Don. And I just really love them. If you're looking for IT training, in my opinion, there's just nowhere better to go. IT Pro TV. Build or expand your IT career and enjoy the journey. We thank them so much for supporting Security Now. They're big fans. All the folks over at IT Pro TV are. Back to you, Steve.
So, Windows 11 has loosened its grip on Edge.
Oh, thank God.
Yes.
Still, doesn't convince me, but...
I know. Last week's Windows Weekly was a bit depressing, listening to Paul and Mary Jo holding Microsoft to account for many of the choices Microsoft has made for the behavior under Windows 11. Among other things, Microsoft is clearly turning Edge from its original clean, user-benefiting browser into another Microsoft profit center. And then adding insult to injury is having Windows 11 actively fighting its users' desire to switch away from Edge to any other browser. Now, in fairness, we've probably all seen we've seen Chrome promoting itself whenever it has the chance. At least I do. You know, Firefox is still the browser that handles my URLs by default, and I'll manually often launch Chrome and use it. Oftentimes, Chrome notices that it's not the default and, you know, gives me some grief for that fact. But it's like, sorry, you know, I like Firefox's down the left-hand column vertically oriented tabs much better than, you know, and I've used Edges too. I've turned that on, and still Firefox is my go-to browser. And it's annoying that there's no obvious way to tell Chrome that things are already just the way I want them to be. Thank you very much. But now that Microsoft is pushing the adoption of Edge quite hard, we're seeing the same from them. Bleeping Computer located the key in the Windows registry, which contains the contents of the various pop-up messages that Microsoft has prepared for Edge. There are five. Currently, first one that may pop up reads, Microsoft Edge runs on the same technology as Chrome, with the added trust of Microsoft. Browse securely now. Okay, I don't know what that means.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Or how? Get this one. That browser is so 2008! Do you know what's new? Microsoft Edge.
Ooh, I want to be with the hip kids.
Come to the future.
Oh, please.
Okay, number three, looking for speed and reliability? Microsoft Edge is the only browser optimized for Windows 10. What? Try a faster browser today. Okay, how about number four? I hate saving money, said no one ever.
That's because they're building in buy now, pay later, and coupon searches. All this crap.
I hate saving money, said no one ever. Microsoft Edge is the best browser for online shopping. Shop smarter now. Oh, Leo. And finally, Microsoft Edge is fast, secure, and the browser recommended by Microsoft.
Well, duh.
discover more benefits. Learn more about Microsoft Edge. Mm-hmm. Now, Bleeping Computer has been unable to trigger some of, I think they've only been able to see two of these five, but those are in there waiting to spring
it's
out.
It's so annoying because it gets triggered when you try to download Chrome, when you go to Chrome, when you, I mean, anything you do, Microsoft feels the necessity to nudge you and say, oh, no, 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 you want Edge.
Yeah, now, there are therapists that could help with this form of insecurity.
Yes.
Okay, in any event, I've already very clearly articulated my feelings about Windows 11, and I'm feeling quite confident that none of my hardware will run on it. So I'm good.
Good.
You know, it's like, sorry, you can't run Windows 11. Fine. That's good. That's right outcome for me. Anyway, I've been shying away from any further kicking of that dog, but in fairness, I wanted to mention a bit of balancing good news that I imagine Paul will also be noting tomorrow. The way things were originally set up in Windows 11 is that Microsoft had eliminated the simple ability of the user to change their system's default browser by removing the UI option to do so. Instead, they granularized the web browser's handling settings by file type, you know, like .htm, .html, .pdf, and so on, and by protocol, HTTP, HTTPS. And so you had to specify, you know, which browser would handle all of those things individually. And they buried all of those options deep in the registry. This forced any determined Windows 11 users to search through the registry, extension by extension and protocol by protocol, to manually change each one in order to unhook Edge. Happily, with last week's release of the Windows 11 Insider Build 22509, Microsoft has restored the presence of a single set default button, and has also surfaced all of those individual file and protocol types in the UI. So a non-Edge browser can now be set as default easily, and then if desired, for some reason, other browsers can override that default for specific file type and protocols. So good on Microsoft for listening to users. I mean, you know, how they'd have to be really deaf not to have heard the outcry over how difficult they had made it not to use Edge under Windows 11. So I just wanted to acknowledge that they had. Okay, also on the Microsoft side, the earliest Windows had the clean and simple Notepad app, which was useful for displaying and editing unformatted and unformattable text files. I still use Notepad every day. I know it's just right there, no BS. When I want to, like, you know, take line wraps out of a block of text, Notepad. You know, and I like Notepad++, you know, just to prevent everyone from telling me about it. I know about it. I have it. I love it. It's annoying that it's constantly updating itself. It's just like, would those guys just please leave it alone? But no. Anyway, Notepad is there. It was implemented as a very lightweight UI around a simple Windows text box container. Basically, it's a UI control widget with a little bit of, you know, load and save UI around it. But Windows also offered WordPad right from the beginning, which allowed for a richer textual formatting experience. It was possible to set the text color, the size, and treatments, such as bolding and italics and so forth, and the text alignment. And just as Notepad was a UI wrapped around the Windows text box container, WordPad's richer textual formatting experience was a UI wrapped around the Windows rich text format, or RTF, container. I've long been a fan of Windows RTF control, and anyone who's ever used any of my Windows software will have seen its embedded pages with some text formatting. That's what I use. I like being able to set some colors and alignment and font sizes and things. All of that in my apps are RTF controls. Okay, in any event, unlike Notepad, the RTF container can also contain embedded things. It can be a host for Olay, the original object linking and embedding objects, because why not? One of the many features of this embedding is the use of so-called formatting templates, which can be loaded on the fly from a file. And wouldn't you know it, malware deployers have figured out that these RTF embeddable template objects will also accept URLs. Oh, Lord. In other words, not just loading them with something local, loading them with something from anywhere in the world. Sounds like a terrifically flexible feature. What could possibly go wrong? Well, how about three different state-sponsored threat actors aligned with China, India, and Russia, all now having been observed adopting this RTF template injection, as it's now being called, as part of their new phishing campaigns to deliver malware into targeted systems. Researchers at Proofpoint have published the results of their research under the title "Injection is the New Black." Novel RTF template injection technique poised for widespread adoption beyond APT actors. They said Proofpoint threat researchers have observed the adoption of a novel and easily implemented phishing technique by APT, you know, advanced persistent threat actors in Q2 and Q3 of 2021. This technique, referred to as RTF template injection, leverages the legitimate RTF template functionality. It subverts the plain text document formatting properties of an RTF file and allows the retrieval of a URL resource instead of a file resource via an RTF's template control word capability. This enables a threat actor to replace a legitimate file destination with a URL from which a remote payload may be retrieved. The sample RTF template injection files analyzed for this publication currently have a lower detection rate by public AV engines when compared to the well-known office-based template injection technique. In other words, this has been adopted because it slips under the radar at this point. Proofpoint has identified distinct phishing campaigns utilizing the template, which have been attributed to a diverse set of advanced persistent threat actors in the wild. While this technique appears to be making the rounds among APT actors in several nations, Proofpoint assesses with moderate confidence, based on the recent rise in its usage and the triviality of its implementation, that it could soon be adopted by other cyber criminals as well. They wrote, RTF template injection is a simple technique in which an RTF file containing decoy content can be altered to allow for the retrieval of content hosted at an external URL upon opening an RTF file. By altering an RTF file's document formatting properties, specifically the document formatting control word --asterisk--template structure, actors can weaponize an RTF file to retrieve remote content by specifying a URL resource instead of an accessible local file resource destination. And they go on at some length to explain this more clearly. So anyway, we know the tune pretty well. Once again, an arguably unnecessary and seldom, if ever, used feature of RTF containers has been found to be exploitable by attackers and is now being used with growing popularity. As proof point suggests, it's too easy to use and too powerful not to become much more widely adopted. I guess what we can hope is that all of the AV scanners and Windows Defender and other tools which are currently not seeing this abuse will be quickly updated in order to catch it. We have an instance of a malicious botnet using the Bitcoin blockchain. Get a load of this one. A botnet, which Google says has infected more than 1 million Windows machines globally and continues to infect new machines at a rate of thousands more per day, is using the public Bitcoin blockchain to stay in touch. Google is suing a pair of Russian individuals it claims are behind this sophisticated botnet operation. In a complaint filed in the U.S. District Court for the Southern District of New York, Google names Russian nationals Dmitry Starovakov and Alexander Filipov as the two main operators of the Glooptiba botnet. Citing Gmail and Google Workspace accounts they allegedly created to help them operate the criminal enterprise. Google claims the defendants used the botnet network, which it describes as a modern, borderless technological embodiment of organized crime, for illicit purposes, including the theft and unauthorized use of Google users' logins and account information. Google is demanding that Dmitry and Alexander pay damages and are permanently banned from using Google services. According to Google, the Glooptiba, G-L-U-P-T-E-B-A, I guess that's Glooptiba.
Glooptiba, botnet. Think you got it. Yep.
I think, which Google has been tracking since last year in 2020, has so far infected approximately 1 million Windows machines worldwide and is growing at a rate, as I said, of a few thousand new machines a day. Once a device has been infected, typically by tricking users into downloading malware via third-party free download sites, the botnet steals user credentials and data, secretly mines cryptocurrencies, and sets up proxies to funnel other people's internet traffic through the infected machines and routers. In its complaint, Google says, quote, "At any moment, the power of the Glooptiba botnet could be used in a powerful ransomware attack or distributed denial of service." Google also noted that the Glooptiba botnet stands out compared to conventional botnets due to its technical sophistication and use of blockchain technology to protect itself from disruption, as well as launching the litigation against this so-called Glooptiba botnet. The company's threat analysis group, that tag team, which has observed the botnet targeting victims in the U.S., India, Brazil, Vietnam, and South Asia, announced it has worked with internet hosting providers to disrupt the botnet's key command and control infrastructure. This means its operators no longer have control of the botnet. though Google has warned that Gloop-Tiba could return due to the fact it uses blockchain technology as a resiliency mechanism. Google explained that the Gloop-Tiba botnet does not rely solely on predetermined web domains to ensure its survival. Instead, when the botnet's CNC server is interrupted, the Gloop-Tiba malware is hard-coded to search the public Bitcoin blockchain for transactions involving three specific Bitcoin addresses that are controlled by the Gloop-Tiba enterprise. Thus, the Gloop-Tiba botnet cannot be eradicated entirely without neutralizing its blockchain-based infrastructure, which I thought was, you know, quite clever. So presumably, the bad guys, if they lose control of the command and control servers, they're able to create transactions which post to the blockchain. The blockchain, of course, records the signatures of the entities that are posting transactions there. The bots then look there and pick up their instructions from details of the transaction. So where there's a will, there's a way. And obviously, unfortunately, there's a lot of will here. HP has been shipping vulnerable printers for the past 8 years. The guys over at F-Secure carefully examined one HP printer. It was an M725Z multifunction device, MFP. But once they reported their findings to HP at the end of April, HP found that their use of common firmware across printers meant that at least 150 other printer models were also affected across the LaserJet, PageWide, and ScanJet families. Updated firmware has been available from HP since November 1st. So anyone having any HP printer who might be a target of either inside or outside attack will definitely wish to update all of their HP printers' firmware. The first of the two problems, tracked as CVE-2021-39288, with a CVS rating of 9.3, describes a vulnerability that can be used to create wormable exploits that can self-replicate and spread to other HP printers inside internal networks or over the internet. The trouble is particularly worrisome because it's a buffer overflow in the printer's font parser. So just causing a vulnerable printer to print a specially crafted page or PDF could take over the printer. The F-Secure researcher said that the flaw can be exploited to gain control over a printer's firmware to steal data or assemble devices into botnets, all while leaving little evidence of exploitation behind, presumably just operating in RAM. They also indicated that attacks that abuse the vulnerability in various other ways, such as attacking internet-exposed devices or by loading the exploit code on a website or inside an ad, can also be successful. Users on corporate networks or those who view the ad will have the code reach out to ports on their internal network to exploit local printers. Wow. The second vulnerability is a local physical USB port attack being tracked as CVE-2021-39237, which impacts the printer's communications board. Fortunately, this bug can only be exploited with physical access to a vulnerable device, and an attack takes up to 5 minutes to execute, compared to the first one, which only takes a few seconds. On the other hand, if you've got printers with exposed USB ports, that's an inside job attack. Some, you know, in a very large corporation where you've got a disgruntled employee, or maybe they've been subverted by an outside entity. You know, hey, you know, we'll pay you $10,000 if you insert this USB stick into one of your company's printers and walk away, you know, wipe off any fingerprints. You know, that would be a model that could also be successful. So as I said, if your enterprise uses HP printers, which are still the world's number one printer by market share, do make some time to update the firmware throughout your organization. Again, it's been available since November. Okay, just a quick touch on Sci-Fi. My nephew is going nuts over Rick Brown's latest novel.
How old is your nephew? Is he 10? Is he 30?
No. He's one of the top performers at Salesforce.
Okay, got it. Okay.
So,
he's a grown-up. Well, that makes a difference.
Yes.
If a 10-year-old says they love Rick Brown, okay, I'm going to take that like a 10-year-old would like it. But he's a grown-up.
Okay. Yeah. I'm more than twice his age.
Okay.
And I can't wait. Anyway, he keeps texting me in all caps. The new novel is so good.
Now, we've read Rick Brown before. This is not a new name.
Oh, yeah. Yes. It's spelled R-Y-K. This is that Frontiers saga.
Yes.
This is the 31st.
Frontiers? Oh, it is. Oh,
yes.
Okay.
Yes, this is the 31st book, and I know that John is up to speed. He's probably already read this 31st book. Anyway, I will get there. My nephew is making me drool for this book, but I'm going to go do the Babaverse first in honor of all of our listeners who have said, Steve, you know, check it out.
The Frontiers saga is kind of one of those space battle type sci-fi books, right? A lot of laser fire and things.
It is, but what it is it's character driven.
Oh, good.
It is so well. I mean, in fact, I have here in my show notes, I said, Rick Brown's latest novel, which presumably details the continuing adventures of Nathan, Cameron, Jessica, Vladimir, Tellez, Josh, Lokai, and all the rest of the wonderfully articulated characters that Rick has created. I mean, that's really what it is. It's so well done because you really get to know these people. Mm. And it's an interesting, you know, the best sci-fi is about the characters, but it also creates some interesting and engaging new technology. So, and this isn't giving anything away, this is set in the far future after the Earth and a number of its neighboring settled planets are recovering from the so-called biodigital plague. And that's never... Rick never goes into great detail about it, but it's something. It was some sort of a digital virus that crossed over into the biosphere and almost wiped out humanity, not only on Earth but everywhere it was able to travel. And a bunch of colony ships went out that were ahead of this biodigital plague, And so humanity dispersed through the universe. So now we're in the process of like getting ourselves, pulling ourselves back up by our bootstraps. What was discovered in the Swiss Alps was an archive of all the stored human knowledge from pre-plague time, which was locked up so the biodigital plague couldn't get in. And so... A new drive technology called the so-called jump drive allows us to jump a great distance instantly, and an accident which occurs at the very start of the first book, which is why this is not a spoiler, has surprising consequences. And I was glad to see some reference elsewhere to it being one of the most popular like science fiction space operas of all time. So it's not just me. I didn't have any sort of calibration, but it is just, and I've read the whole 30 books twice now, actually the big, you know, and I'm finishing up 30, then I'm going to switch to the Babaverse. But it's just, if you know, it's not going to change you, but if you just enjoy, you know, really well done adventures. It is definitely that.
Nice.
Okay, so that heuristic hardware interrupt handling solution that I mentioned last week, which I developed for SpinRite, appears to have solved a number of current and doubtless future troubles. You know, as I've mentioned, I take every single problem that our testers can find absolutely seriously, because I learned a long time ago, if it happens to one person, it'll happen to, you know, 100. So thanks to additional feedback from our testers and my hours of staring at code, we have, you know, and then a number of additional tests and incremental improvements, you know, up in the very far right corner of that screenshot, it said developer or development release 7F. And so we had 7, and then we quickly had A, B, C, D, E, F, because they didn't feel like they were big enough to go jump to 8. But I kept hoping I was going to, you know, hit the magic solution for whatever problem I was trying to track down. So we've had a bunch of tests and incremental improvements. What's been so gratifying is that as testers have swung by the development group over the weekend, one after another, they've reported that this or that trouble their systems used to have is now gone, and that SpinRite's latest development release is now working perfectly for them. So we've seen a lot of progress. But there are a few exceptions, and they're nasty. A couple of people have reported that the size of the first drive in the list is being confused with the size of the last BIOS drive in their system. It doesn't happen to me, nor to most people, but it reliably happens to a couple of our testers. So something different is going on in their systems. One person has a 70 terabyte Drobo directly attached to their system and is bio accessible. And that was crashing SpinRite because I wasn't ready for a 70 terabyte drive, which is overflowing some register space. So I'll expand that.
The other thing with Drobos is they're not always reporting the actual space.
Yes, that's exactly what we saw. He said he only had 32 terabytes, but it's saying 70.
Yeah, that's true.
So it's like,
right there.
Yeah. And a few others are reporting something really odd. SpinRite's own division overflow pop-up is popping up. Now, the pop-up tells us where the division overflow occurred. But when I look there in SpinRite's code, there's no division instruction at that location. So the only conclusion is that something is causing SpinRite's own code to be overwritten. Fortunately, what's being overwritten contains either an F6 or an F7, which are the x86 division opcodes. So I know where the first drive's size is stored, which something is changing later when it shouldn't. And that errant division overflow pop-up tells us where a division instruction has mysteriously appeared in SpinRite's code. So we need to track down what's going on with the drive size being changed and the code being overwritten. To do that, we need to catch the overwriting action in the act as it's happening. The problem is, I've never been able to reproduce any of those problems myself. It's only happening on a few distant machines. The answer, which I will immediately implement a few hours from now, maybe in the morning, depending upon how I'm feeling after the podcast, is to build a native debugger directly into SpinRite. And that's actually easier than it sounds. The Intel x86 architecture has always incorporated built-in hardware debugging assistance. It has 4 32-bit breakpoint registers, which can be set to point to any region of the system's memory. Each of the 4 breakpoint registers can be set to interrupt the processor upon the execution, the reading, or the writing of that memory with a 1, 2, 4, or 8 byte span. So this next test release of SpinRite will add a couple of new command line options to load and enable those debug registers. Once a tester has seen where SpinRite reported an erroneous division instruction, they'll be able to immediately rerun it, setting a write breakpoint at that spot in SpinRite's code, which will allow us to catch in the act whoever is overwriting SpinRite. I'm assuming it's me with some errant code of mine. It might be their BIOS. Again, I can't make it happen. They can make it happen, and this will allow anybody to work with me, essentially doing remote debugging of the code using the x86 debugging instructions. So we're going to have an interesting time in the next week, and I probably report that SpinRite is, you know, got these problems solved by a week from now.
Wow, that's amazing. That's amazing. Meanwhile, I'm still playing bingo with some squid on my submarine. So,
or as Lori says, I made the bed.
I got something done today. You know, that's good. That's good. Steve, let's take a break. Then we're going to get into the meat of the matter.
Whatever, XSinator.
Whatever you mean by XSinate, we will find out in just a moment. But first, a word from my favorite, and I have to say this is a relatively new situation this year, mostly password manager. So I always, first of all, there's not even a question. Use a password manager, okay? Just use it. We had a caller on the radio show on Sunday who said, "Yeah, my bank password was guessed." Guessed, I said. I said, "Was it monkey123? He said, no, it was a good password. I said, "Well, I got a question for you. Do you think you might have used that password anywhere else?" And he said, "Oh, yeah, I use it all the time." I said, "Well, that's how they guessed it, from a breach of your password somewhere else." He said, "Well, I use a password manager, but I didn't use it to generate my passwords." So that's very important. What is a password manager? Well, in case of Bitwarden, it's a totally secure encrypted password vault where all of your passwords, and by the way, anything else you want, I keep my vaccine certificate there, I keep my passport there, my driver's license, anything else you want to keep secure, I keep everybody's social security number there because you want to keep that secure. So it's an encrypted blob only you have access to, but that's not all a password manager does. A password manager should also generate good, long, strong, totally random, and of course, as a result, completely unmemorable passwords. And that's what Bitwarden does so well. And I also should point out, Bitwarden will go through your passwords and say, you reused that one, and help you change it. So they have a security audit as well, because you don't want to reuse. That's what happened to this guy. I said, go to Pwn to Own, enter your password. I bet you anything, it's been seen in a number of breaches. But if you just use a good password vault, if you use Bitwarden, you don't have to worry about it. Now, Bitwarden is, of course, the only open source cross-platform password manager that can be used at home, at work, on the go. It's trusted by millions, and it's a great choice for your business, too. That's what I want to pitch you on right now. What's cool about Bitwarden is the individual Bitwarden account, free forever. Because they're open source. Their business model does not require them to convert free users to paid users. That's not how it works. They're an open source password manager. So, in fact, you can even, if you want, they've open sourced the server. You can run your own server if you want. You know, you can do it all. In fact, it's open source, so there's a guy who's written a really nice, lightweight Bitwarden server in Rust. Super secure. You've got complete flexibility. And I love it for that reason. And if you want to have a business Bitwarden account, the way it works is you have all your employees set up their individual account, and then they join your organizational vault. Now, of course, when we're talking enterprise, there's a lot more you want from a password manager. For instance, Bitwarden for business is fully customizable. You have all sorts of policies you can enforce. You can adjust features to adapt your business needs. You also get Bitwarden Send, which is a fully encrypted method to transmit sensitive information, whether text or files. If you're an accountant, if you're a physician, this is a way to transmit private data. The recipient does not have to have a Bitwarden account to access it.
Bitwarden for Enterprise lets team members generate, of course, unique secure passwords for every site. You get to set policies about that as well. And it's enterprise-grade security that is fully compliant with GDPR, California CCPA, HIPAA for health providers, SOC 2. And because it's storing passwords, it mitigates phishing attacks. People sometimes ask me, well, how does that help? Well, you go to a site that pretends to be your bank, Bitwarden can see the difference and will not autofill that phishing site. So you don't have to, you want your employees to use this, bottom line. Two new features for enterprise. They just announced this for this month. If you are currently a part of a Bitwarden cloud-based enterprise plan, all of your users will be granted free Bitwarden family accounts that give premium features to up to 6 total family members. That's a great, great thing. In fact, that's something we did as a business, and I think really you should do, because you want to encourage password security, not just at the business, but at home too. Also, they've added login with single sign-on, login with SSO. This is a new option for customer-managed encryption. It enables a self-hosted enterprise, and Steve, you'll understand this and appreciate it, to use a local key server to manage vault encryption keys. So it gives you SSO at work. Employees can access and decrypt their Bitwarden vault through their SSO credentials. This solves that one little problem with any password manager. You have to remember how to unlock it. Now you've got SSO, no additional passwords or login information, and it's more secure. Fantastic. If you're interested in a business plan, Bitwarden has a number of plans for your organization. The Teams organization option, $3 a month per user. You can share private data securely with your coworkers, department, or entire organization. That's a big part of any business password manager, is secure sharing of passwords. People are going to share passwords. You don't want them texting them. You don't want them writing them on Post-it notes. You don't want them emailing them. So Bitwarden makes that possible. If you're a larger enterprise, Bitwarden's enterprise organization plan, $5 per month per user. And there's always the free organization plan. That's 2 users. You can store and secure passwords. And of course, as I mentioned, they have family plans and they have individual plans. And honestly, I pay for Bitwarden because I love it so much. It's, for me, it's less than $1 a month. And I want to support them. I really do. But the personal plan is free forever. Last chance to register for their free open source security summit. You're going to like this panel. It's coming up December 9th, day after tomorrow. Nicole Perlroth, Steve Wozniak, and Bruce Schneier are the keynotes. Wow. December 9th, 7 a.m. to 10 a.m. Pacific, 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Eastern time. That's 3 people I'd love to hear from. Bitwarden believes everyone should have access to basic password security tools. Individuals can use their basic free account, as I mentioned, forever for an unlimited number of passwords, and it works on all your devices. You get all the benefits of a real password manager for free. You can upgrade to a premium account for less than $1 a month. That's my account. If you're looking for secure password storage for the family organization option, 6 users, premium features, $3.33 a month, not per person, but total. I think Bitwarden is just great. And, of course, you can use the Bitwarden cloud to store your vault. But the personal plans, you can use your own, you know, Dropbox or whatever you want for the vault if you don't want to, if you really want, you know, trust no one. You can monitor and manage security vulnerabilities using their vault health reports from Bitwarden. As I mentioned, you can identify exposed, reused, weak, or potentially compromised passwords, as well as any items in your vault with an active 2FA. We really love that 2FA. You want to turn it on. It'll say, no, you could use 2FA on this account. Do you want to turn it on? I think that's really important. And again, knowing that your password's been compromised and reused would have saved this guy a lot of trouble. Get started with a free Teams or Enterprise trial of a Teams or Enterprise plan. All you got to do is go to bitwarden.com/twit or try it for free across all your devices as an individual user. That's how I started using Bitwarden, and I tell you, no turning back. I love it. bitwarden.com/twit. I'm a believer in open source. That's why I'm a big believer in Bitwarden. They can never take it away from you. All right, Steve, let's talk about, what is it, SigSnick? What are you talking about?
I would assume we would pronounce it XSinator, X-S-I-N-A-T-O-R, XSinator.
XSinator sounds right, yeah.
Okay. Their paper is titled XSinator.com, From a Formal Model to the Automatic Evaluation of Cross-Site Leaks in Web Browsers.
Oh, XS as in cross-site. Okay.
Exactly, okay. Cross-site. It's a result of a comprehensive work conducted by a team of five German university researchers. And as a result of their work, they discovered 14 new types, 14 new types of cross-site data leakage, which are effective against, well, I think every browser. Tor, Firefox, Chrome, Edge, Safari, Opera, and others. Both desktop and mobile, as I said. And going to XSinator.com allows you to run the test that they've designed, which will profile your own browser, and then and it shows up in the left-hand column, and then allow you to compare it against all the other browsers which have been profiled. So they call the bugs XS leaks, you know, as in cross-site leaks, because they enable malicious websites to harvest the personal data from their visitors as they interact with other websites in the background. That is, as the hostile website you go to, or for that matter, an ad that is, you know, running a script. All that has to happen is script is run in your browser. Then reach out using JavaScript, using Ajax to create connections to other browsers with which you have a relationship. In a recent statement about their research, which was presented during last month's 2021 ACM SIGSAC conference on computer and communication security, which, by the way, their presentation garnered a Best Paper Award, they explained. They said, XS leaks bypass the so-called same origin policy, and whoops, we know how crucial that is in our browsers for browser security. One of a browser's, they wrote, main defenses against various types of attacks. The purpose of the same origin policy is to prevent information from being stolen from a trusted website. In the case of XS leaks, attackers can nevertheless recognize individual small details of a website. In these details, if these details are tied to personal data, they said, those data can be leaked. Now, our listeners probably know by now that I'm a sucker for formally proven security findings. That, you know, there's certainly a place for fuzzing, which is probably the other end of that spectrum from formal proofs. And formal proofs won't help when modeling cannot be applied. But whenever possible, creating a mathematically formal model of a system, then using that model to reach and or demonstrate security conclusions is, in my mind, the gold standard. So here's how this team describes what they've accomplished. In their abstract for their paper, they said, a cross-site leak describes a client-side bug that allows an attacker to collect side-channel information from a cross-origin HTTP resource. They wrote, they pose a significant threat to internet privacy, since simply visiting a web page may reveal if the victim is a drug addict or leak a sexual orientation. Numerous different attack vectors, as well as mitigation strategies, have been proposed, but a clear and systematic understanding of cross-site leak root causes is still missing, or at least was before they began this. They said recently, Sudhodanan et al. Gave a first overview of a cross-site leak at the Network and Distributed System Security Symposium, that's NDSS. They said, we build on their work by presenting the first formal model for cross-site leaks. Our comprehensive analysis of known cross-site leaks reveals that all of them fit into this new model. With the help of this formal approach, we, one, systematically searched for new cross-site leak attack classes, two, implemented XSinator.com, a tool to automatically evaluate if a given web browser is vulnerable to cross-site leaks, and 3, systematically evaluated mitigations for cross-site leaks. We found 14 new attack classes, evaluated the resilience of 56 different browser OS combinations against a total of 34 cross-site leaks, and propose a completely novel methodology to mitigate cross-site leaks. Now, in the show notes, I have my own results using Firefox and Chrome. Firefox 94 on the left, Chrome on the right. And red is bad. There's a lot of red there. Both Firefox and Chrome. In their paper, and I did not include it in the show notes, I forgot, they have some other tables where they show all of the tests and all of the different browsers and version numbers. And for what it's worth, Firefox has fewer reds than anything else. The Tor browser, which of course is based on Firefox, has even a few fewer. So Leo, now you have on the screen I guess that's the pre-test page. And up at the top there, you're able to click a blue button, which is like right there, and click it, and it will begin, it will initiate the test, which is now underway on your browser. So we'll see how that comes out.
How long is this going to take?
It's only a few minutes.
Okay. I'll be back with you in a minute.
And I think that opened another tab. Switch back to the first tab.
Yeah.
And you might be able to see it operating if it opened
it's running,
a second.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, there it is. And you're seeing you're beginning to get some reds.
Oh, these are the initial results. Okay, yeah.
Yep. There I think so, it's still process.
What are these things? Is there something I should be worried about here?
Yeah, that's why we're talking about this today.
I'm in Firefox doing this. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So in a web application, they explain, a web browser interacts with several different web servers through HTTP or WebSocket connections. The client-side logic of the web application is written in HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, and is executed inside a tab of the browser or inside an inline frame in another application, or an ad. The execution context of a web application is defined through the concept of web origins. Web applications may call and embed other web applications to enhance functionality. For example, a hotel reservations site might embed Google Maps and public transportation sites as an easy method to allow its customers to determine how to reach the hotel. In such situations, cross-origin HTTP requests between different web origins, meaning the hotel's origin and the maps server origin, are necessary to retrieve data to embed and display in the web application. When interacting with a website, a user has a well-defined state. This state typically contains the information such as whether the user is logged into the site currently or not. Besides the login status, the user state may contain account permissions such as admin privileges, premium membership, or restricted accounts. The number of different user states is potentially unlimited. For example, in a webmail application, a user may or may not have received an email with the subject top secret. Okay, so they say under privacy risks of cross-origin requests, consider the following situation. The attacker has lured a victim to a malicious web application that executes hidden cross-origin HTTP requests to different drug counseling sites. If the attacker could learn whether the victim has logged in at one of these drug counseling sites, the attacker could gain highly privacy-critical information about the victim. To distinguish between two user states, the attacker's JavaScript code must be able to identify differences in its own execution environment resulting from different responses to cross-origin HTTP requests. These different responses must correspond to different user states at the target, that's sort of the victim, web application. If this differentiation is possible, we call this vulnerability a cross-site leak. The attacker could then craft a malicious website which triggers the cross-site leak once the victim visits it. Okay, we'll get specific here in a second. So then they give two real-world examples. An XS leak on GitLab. They wrote, GitLab is a popular web application for collaborative software development hosted by many companies. GitLab provides a profile URL, which is https://git.company.com/profile. If the user is not logged in, this URL redirects the user to https://git.company.com/users/sign-in. If the user is logged in, the current user's profile is shown. However, since the attacker embeds GitLab cross-origin into the attacker's own web page, the attacker cannot directly read the URL. In listing one above, and I've included it in the show notes, we use the window.length property, which is readable cross-origin, to determine the user's state at the other site. The profile page does not contain any iframes, but the login page includes 3 iframes. If this property, window.length, has the value 3, that means the user is not currently logged in. If it has the value 0, the user is logged in. By scanning different company websites hosting GitLab, the attacker can collect information on a programmer's affiliations. So there's an example of true cross-origin information leakage, where a site you visit or an ad hosted by a benign site is able to determine things about you and your current state with other domains, with other websites. And it works on Google Mail. They give an example of a cross-site leak on Google Mail. They say Google Mail, one of the most popular webmail applications. In 2019, Terjank, T-E-R-J-A-N-Q, reported a cross-site leak which could determine whether an email with a certain subject, for example, drug counseling, or content, which could or content was present in the user's inbox cross-origin. In other words, it's possible to reach into a user's Gmail this way. The cross-site leak abused the common cache that web applications share. By using the advanced search option, which can be called cross-origin, Google Mail marks search results, if any exist, with a dedicated image. To perform a cross-site leak attack, the attacker first empties the web cache, which can be done locally, then calls Google Mail advanced search using a URL, which can be done, and finally checks if the dedicated image is available in the cache. If true, the search was successful, and the attacker learned that an email containing whatever search term the attacker queried currently exists in the target's, the victim's inbox. Okay, so let's make sure that everyone understands where we are. Any Gmail user visits some random nosy website. Without any indication of any kind, that nosy website running JavaScript on the user's web browser is able to use subtle and clever tricks to perform as many go-no-go searches of the user's Gmail inbox as they wish against their current content entirely behind their backs and without their knowledge. We've talked about this general class of web browser hacks a number of times in the past. Broadly speaking, it is incredibly difficult to robustly prevent any cross-domain leakage. We've seen that initially benign-seeming convenience features, such as changing the color of previously visited links, can compromise privacy when website A uses the user's browser to display website B off-screen and then probes website B's DOM, the document object model, for the colors of various links. In this way, information that is none of website A's business leaks from users from the user's previous use of website B. What this team has done is further explore and rigorously map brand new forms of subtle side-channel cross-origin information leakage. And they've come away with a surprisingly large number of new ways for clever attackers to leverage deliberate features of JavaScript, like using the window length of some other website's page to infer information that's none of their business about the browser's owner. We've seen that previous cross-domain cookie and cache attacks have led browser developers to segment all cookie storage by domain, and to similarly segment all browser cache by domain. Since the performance impact of this is negligible, the great impact is upon browser complexity and maintenance, which have skyrocketed. You know, if you've looked at the number of processes today running when you launch your web browser, it's like clearly a huge burden now on browser developers. Like today's operating systems, web browsers are no longer something that can be casually assembled. But the nature of the leakage these guys have uncovered and demonstrated is different from that, because it leverages the non-gray area features of our browsers. They're employing features that are there by design. This suggests, in turn, that in the future, our web browsers may choose to deliberately strip these side channel features and limit JavaScript's interaction with cross-origin domains. And that would probably be a good thing. It's going to be tough because it's going to change some functionality. But, you know, what we've seen is that the browser vendors are extremely conscious of this kind of cross-origin privacy leakage, and this paper just unveiled a huge new assortment of ways that can be done.
Really interesting. Yeah.
Yeah.
So presumably Chrome, Firefox, the browser
all
guys will fix this. Yes, it's fixable,
yes.
Right?
Yes. And that's the upside of this kind of research and this kind of testing site. This will immediately subject the browser vendors to significant pressure, which
they need.
Is not their fault, but
no,
they do need the pressure.
It. Now, Grayson Peddle in our Discord chat has a question, which I think is germane. If you're using a browser that sandboxes tabs, does that keep the cross-site scripting from happening? They can't communicate with one another, right?
I don't think tab sandboxing would work, because in a tab, the JavaScript is using HTTP queries and WebSockets to contact to bring another domain into it.
Right.
So it's not having to talk across
the tab. Oh, it
bypasses
the tab. It's in one tab. It's in one process.
Exactly. Yeah. It's all happening on the page the user is currently visiting.
Apparently, there's some sort of container method for Firefox.
Well, and Leo, the fact that we're seeing red when we click that button, those are effective, successful cross-domain probes that have just occurred.
Right. Okay. So, Grayson, is there a special version of a Firefox that containerizes
the various instances. I don't even know if that would help because it's all happening within one instance, right?
Yes, it's on the current tab. He's certainly referring to the tab isolation.
Yeah, that's what I thought he was. But
yes, that's a great point. But here it's script in your on the page is poking at other domains behind your back, and so. The problem is that those domains know about your browser. So when JavaScript in your browser pokes at those domains, the cookies that you have, the other information that your browser has about those domains go along with those queries. And so that's how those foreign domains respond differently to you. It's because your browser, via the JavaScript running on that page, has asked them something, and their behavior subtly changes when it's you asking versus somebody else asking.
So interesting. That's good research. Nicely done.
It's really well done.
Yeah. And of course, so is this show, thanks to this guy right here, Mr. Stephen Tiberius Gibson. If you want to, we have lots of ways to get this show. Of course, you can go right to Steve's site, grc.com, and get 16 kilobit audio as well as 64 kilobit audio if you want to save on download bytes. Also, the transcripts, which he commissions from Elaine Ferris, are really good and a great way to search any Security Now episode. You've got transcripts for all 848? No.
Yeah, we went back. And did them from the beginning.
Really makes this a very valuable resource. grc.com. While you're there, pick up Steve's bread and butter, the one and only thing that makes him money. So buy a copy of SpinRite, the world's finest mass storage maintenance and recovery utility. 6.0 is the current version, but as you can tell, he's working hard on 6.1. You'll get to participate in the development and get a free upgrade if you buy today. grc.com. You can also lots of other stuff there. It's a really
completely rewritten, and I didn't even change the major version number of the darn thing.
Yeah. Yeah, why didn't you make it SpinRite 7?
Because I promised everybody a free upgrade. So everyone's getting
okay.
a free upgrade.
And you also made some promises about what 7 might mean. And so, right?
Yeah. 7 will definitely go further, and it'll run on UEFI systems.
That's the big difference.
And also have native drivers for USB attached devices and NVMe, which we're also seeing.
And it'll basically open it up to Mac users, which is great.
Yep.
Yeah. So you'll get 6.1, but then it's time for 7.0. And if Steve lives long enough, if I live long enough, we'll deliver that as well, but not for free. There you go. Leave feedback at grc.com/feedback. You can also slide into his DMs, as the kids say, on Twitter. He's SGGRC, and his DMs are open. So questions or comments can be left there. Proposals for the picture of the week, that kind of thing. Let's see, what else? We have copies of the show on our website. We have 64 kilobit audio also, but we also have a unique format. We have a video. If you want to see Steve's mustache in action, you can go to twit.tv/SN. You can also subscribe in your favorite podcast client, which is probably the best way. That way you'll get it automatically. Now, let's not forget, and we talked about it earlier, Club TWiT is a way to get ad-free versions of all the shows. It's $7 a month. You get ad-free versions, and you get access to the Discord, which is great, just really a great community. That's where Stacey's doing her science fiction book club. That's where we've got the Untitled Linux show. Mary Jo Foley just did an Ask Me Anything, and we are, I don't know if they've contacted you, but Ant, who's our community manager, really wants you to do a vitamin D thing for the Discord, for the club.
That'd be fun.
Okay. Well, expect an email because now he's got to do it. And all of that stuff ends up, you can watch it live, participate live in the Discord, but it also ends up on the special TWiT Plus feed, which is also available ad-free only to club members. So take advantage of that, and it sure helps us. And yes, we have corporate memberships at a reduced rate. twit.tv/clubtwit. The show we do live Tuesdays right after MacBreak Weekly, 1:30 to 2 p.m. Pacific. Let's make it 2 p.m., 5 p.m. Eastern time. 2200 UTC. If you want to watch or listen live, the stream is at live.twit.tv. The streams, there's several of them. People who are watching live are often in the Discord, in our club, or on our free IRC server, irc.twit.tv. That's a community-run resource. Thanks to all of our mods. They're really amazing in there, starting with Osnet and ScooterX and just a great bunch of people in there. That's always a lot of fun, and that's free and wide open. You can use a browser or an IRC client, irc.twit.tv. We also have forums. Steve's got forums. We had to have them. So we have discourse forums, discourse, not Discord, at twit.community. We have a Mastodon instance at twit.social. If you feel like tweeting in a nice group of people, twit.social. We don't call it tweeting in Mastodon. We call it tooting. So toot along. I know what you're thinking. I should also mention
Beans, the wonderful. Yeah.
Yes. That's exactly what I thought. I forget to mention, and I want to mention this a little. It's almost like a tech support note, but we also offer ad-free versions of all of the shows as individual subscriptions through iTunes, through Apple's podcast client. I think it's $2.99 per show. So if you just want Security Now, less than $3 a month, you get Security Now. But, and this is I think it's a bug in Apple's system. Don't be too in much of a hurry to get it there. Because what happens, we upload the thing and then there's some disconnect, but for a brief moment of time, I don't know, it might be like 30 seconds. If you're there right when we upload the show, you'll get the version with ads. So a number of people said, wait a minute, I pay $2.99. There should be no ads. Yeah. Because of the way Apple does it, it doesn't switch over to the ad free version right away. There's a lag. And we don't know why that is. We've talked to Apple. We hope they fix it. But in the meanwhile, don't be in a hurry. If you pay for the ad-free version through podcasts, the Apple Podcast app, let Apple's podcast get it. And I think that should work out all right. Don't force it, in other words. I think that's it. I think we've done everything. Steve, you're the best. While you were talking, I was able to find the bug in my day 4 solution of Advent of Code. Moving on.
Cool. Nice.
I just transposed some lines. You know, it's one of those things. I kept getting a weird error message.
I do.
Got to put the break higher up in the fourfold. What was I thinking? So we'll see you next time, next Tuesday on Security Now.
Thanks, buddy.
Have you ever read a tech news story and thought to yourself, man, I would love to talk to the person who wrote this to find out more information? Well, that's exactly what Micah Sargent and I, Jason Howell, do each and every week on Tech News Weekly. We read the stories that matter to us, we reach out to the people making a break in the tech news, and we invite them on to tell their story. And you can find it at twit.tv. Look for Tech News Weekly every Thursday.
Security Now.